One of the limiting factors for setting up clusters in the cloud has been that we cannot use shared resources between all the servers in the cluster, and that's where you put those virtual machines or file services, SQL databases, etc. And we have not been able to do this in the cloud until now. Today we're talking about Azure Shared Disk. I'm Dean Cifola, and this is the Azure Academy. If you want to master the Azure Cloud, you can start right now by clicking the subscribe button and the notification bell so you don't miss anything. Clustering has been something that is traditionally difficult to set up and requires lots of resources as well as expertise to get up and running. The idea is to pass around the resources from one node in the cluster to another so that they can be highly available. So if you lose one particular node, you don't lose everything. So here's the plan for clusters. We're going to first go over some of the basics of running a cluster in Azure. Then we're going to build the Azure resources for our scale-out file server. Third, we're going to set up that cluster. Finally, we are going to automate everything. So here in the Azure portal, I've got a cluster that's already built out, and the things that make this unique from how clustering has been attempted in the past, you don't see a load balancer here at all. This is because of something in Windows Server 2019 where we can use something called a distributed network name instead of a load balancer's IP address to give the cluster a presence on the network. We also have a proximity placement group, and we have covered those before on the channel, so I'll link that up here at the top. You can go check that out. And basically what this does is it puts the resources that are within the proximity placement group as close to each other as possible. And this is to keep the latency between them low, which is a requirement for our shared disk. Then we have our two virtual machines. And if I click on our first VM and I just take a look at our disks. Now, if I click on the data disk under the configuration, we see that this is just a 1 terabyte premium SSD. And there's really nothing more remarkable here. Now going back for a second here, you see the name of the disk is Sophos-DataDisk0. And if we go back to our resource group and look at our other virtual machine under disks, we have the same data disk attached. This is what a shared disk resource is. And there is a particular limit to how many VMs can attach to a single data disk. And that's covered in the Azure documentation, which is linked in the video description below. And it shows you this table here for the SSDs. And based on the particular size of the SSD is how many VMs you can attach. Like I have a 1 terabyte disk, that's a P30. So I could attach 5 VMs to that disk. So let's get this party started with a clean resource group. And the first thing we're going to need is a proximity placement group. I'll type that in here and hit create. I'll build this in the East US and call my group clus-ppg-1. Click next for my tags. Adding my cost code so I know who's paying for this, the application being clusters in Azure, and this is my lab environment. So let's get that created. And there's our placement group. So now we can build our VMs into it. And I'll search for Windows Server 2019 in the marketplace and click on Windows Server. Then I can select the particular SKU that I'm interested in. And I'll scroll down near the bottom here for the small disk Server 2019, since the operating system disk does not need to be that large. So I filled out the first page here, and I do need to add an availability set. So that way I'm sure that the VMs end up on different hardware in the back end. And I'll call the AV set clus-AV set and leave the fault and update domains alone. And we'll click next for our disks. And the operating system disk, I'll just leave as a premium disk, but I will not add any data disks at this point. And you'll see why in a minute. We hit next for network. I'll provision this on my network that's already connected to my domain controllers. You will need to join your VMs to your domain for clustering to work. And if we scroll down a little bit here, I have the option to enable accelerated networking with a particular VM size that I chose, which was the DS4V2. And accelerated networking is going to give our systems a little boost in network performance. We'll skip the management tab here and go to advanced, where we need to scroll down and select our proximity placement group. Then we'll hit next and add our tags. And I'll add the same ones that I did for our PPG and hit review and create. And now to save some time, I'll also click to download our template, copy all of that, and then open a duplicate tab the search bar at the top, I'll type deploy and click to deploy a custom template, then click to build it in the editor. And I'll highlight all the code here and just delete it all and then paste in my template code. And we'll be provisioning three resources here, the availability set, the VM, and a network card. Go back to the original tab and then click on the parameters section, copy everything and go back to my duplicate tab, click the edit parameters button, highlight and delete everything, and then paste and hit save, and that'll fill out the template for me. So I get all the same values. Now, important here is that the first VM needs to go as far as to create the availability set first. So we're gonna kick that one off while we finish filling this guy out. We'll hit create there. And as soon as we see that the availability set has been built, we can go and finish building the other template. We'll build it in the same resource group, change the value for our NEC card, as well as change the name for our virtual machine to Clus01. And the rest of it should be good. So let's hit review and create. And now we're building both virtual machines at the same time. And you can see that the availability set was instantly marked as okay because that resource already exists. So our first VM looks like it's complete. And if we scroll down a little bit in the center of the blade, we are in proximity placement group Clus PPG1, which is exactly what we want. So I've opened another tab here, and this is on my GitHub repo. And at the top, we'll click on repositories, where I've added a brand new repository for clustering. And in here, I've got a template to deploy shared disks, as well as a deploy to Azure button, which I'll click now. We'll select our resource group is the same one that we're already using. Our name for our shared disk will be shared disk-0, and our size defaults here to 1 terabyte. But depending on how many VMs you're provisioning, you can do whatever size you like. So for now, I'll just change this to 256, which means I'll be able to attach 2 VMs. Now, before I click on create, I want to click on edit template here because there is something to take note of. And if we scroll down to our disk resource, the important thing here is this parameter, max shares. And that's what we saw from the table in the documentation. And max shares indicates how many VMs I'm connecting to this disk. In this case, just 2. So I'll click save for that and then hit review and create and then create our disk. So we're almost there, but to finish setting up our cluster, we need to set up something called the quorum. And this is where we decide how we're going to manage the cluster. So we're going to build a regular storage account. So we'll scroll down, select our storage. So I filled out all the values here, and this can just be a standard storage account with locally redundant storage. This is only to hold our quorum. We'll skip ahead and add our tags. And then we'll hit the review and create. So while we're waiting for that, we'll go into our VMs and go to our disks and attach an existing disk. We'll just click the dropdown and there's our shared disk that we had provisioned earlier. Click save. And then we'll go back to our other VM and we'll repeat the same process. Attach an existing disk, pick our shared disk, and then hit save. Now, if you do this on a regular disk that doesn't have that max share enabled, you will not be able to complete this, but that little parameter makes all the magic happen. And our storage account is complete as well, so we can now join our VMs to the domain and then proceed with the cluster setup. And now that our servers are joined to the domain, in the server manager, we'll go to manage and add a new role or feature, and we'll add it for the particular server that we're on. And on the role screen, we'll click next. Then we'll add the failover clustering. Keep scrolling down, and then we'll add a remote server tool under features for the clustering tools. And just be sure that you have the management tool and the PowerShell module. We'll click next for that and then hit install. And you just want to be sure that you execute those steps on both of your VMs. And after the role installation is complete, we need to reboot. And once both of our nodes have rebooted, we want to go to tools in the server manager, go to failover cluster manager. And over on the right, we want to click to validate our configuration. And we'll click next to start the wizard, click browse and add our cluster nodes. And we'll select both of them and hit OK. And by the nodes being added here successfully, that means that the cluster role has been installed on both of them. We'll click next, and then we'll run only the selected tests So we'll click next through the rest of the wizard and let's just let that run. Now, if I scroll all the way to the bottom before we continue, there is a warning here about our network. Traditional clustering wants there to be at least 2 network interfaces on the machine. And that is because you, again, want to keep your clusters as highly available as possible. So no single points of failure. And it's recognizing that our VMs have only 1 network card. This is not a problem in Azure because the network that we're using is a software-defined network. So we abstract away all the physical hardware, which is highly redundant underneath all of this. So we can just move on and not concern ourselves with this particular issue. So we'll check the box to build the cluster from our validated nodes and hit finish. And that'll open the Create Cluster Wizard. We'll give our cluster a name. I'll just call it the AZ cluster and click next, and then we'll hit next, and that has completed, so we can hit finish. We have a cluster now, and over in Active Directory, we've got our 2 cluster nodes as well as the cluster computer object as well. Now the next step is we need to set up our quorum. So this will be a cloud witness. So I'll right click on the cluster here, go down to more actions, and then configure our quorum settings. And the wizard will start off with clicking next. We'll click the middle option here to select the quorum witness and click next, and we'll configure a cloud witness. Click next, and we need the name of our storage account. Back in the Azure portal, we'll just click on our storage account and copy the name. We'll drop that here in the wizard, and now we need the storage account key, and that's here in the blade on the left under access keys. And I'll just copy key number 1, and then we'll drop that in here as well. And then we'll hit next, next again to complete the setup, and then hit finish. And there is our cloud witness. And if we go back to disk management, we want to initialize our disk. And then back in the cluster, we'll go to add our disk, and it's been detected properly, and we'll hit OK. That is now part of our cluster. And now's the point where you have to decide what your cluster is going to do. So if we want to make this a scale out file cluster, we're going to need to add the file services from Windows. And similarly, if we want it to be a Hyper-V cluster, then we have to add those features as well. I'll go back to the server manager and we'll go to add a role. And under the file and storage services, we'll click to add our file server. And then we'll click next through the rest of the wizard and then click to repeat all of those steps on the other service in the cluster as well. Once that's complete, back in the cluster, we'll go to add our role again. This time, click on file server, then click next. And here we can add a general purpose file server or a scale out file server for application data. And that's the one I'll choose and click next. And I'll call this the AZ-SOFIS and click next and next again. And that's going to set up the role to be highly available. And once that's complete, we'll click finish. And now we've got a scale out file server role and we do have a share set up. Then we can right click on the disk and add to cluster shared volumes. And that'll change the path down here at the bottom to be a volume followed by a GUID. And that's to show that the location of this clustered shared volume is now on the C drive under clustered storage volume 1. And pulling up the other node in the cluster, we go to the same location and there is the same volume. We'll just add a new folder directory. And if we go back to where the cluster manager was open, there is the folder. And we can also delete it. So this is a completely shared disk. So just to finish out the process, we'll go to our roles and then right click to add a file share. Because this is a scale out file server, we'll go for an SMB application share. Click next and you should have your cluster shared volume in the middle, which you'll click that. Hit next and then give it a share name, something just like data, and we'll click next. And then you can set any of these settings as is appropriate for your workload, as well as setting any of the permissions, and then hit create. Congratulations, you have set up a scale out file server. And if we go to the network share that we're hosting, yes, we can get access. Create a new folder, create a new document, we'll save that. And from the other node, we'll go under our shares, data, new folder, test, and there everything is working. Now this of course completes the whole process of how we can set up and use a shared disk, but I wanna show you a much faster way to get this done. Over in the Azure Docs, we've got some quick samples, and this is also linked in the video description. And these samples cover everything from SQL to file servers, SAP services, Linux clusters with Pacemaker, etc. So today we're going to build from the scale-out file server, and this will be basically a quick template version of what I've already shown you. And if we scroll down in this GitHub page to deploy to Azure, Then all we need to do is fill out this template. Now with that complete, there's a couple points of interest here. One is that the name prefix needs to be all in lowercase because this is going to be used in setting up your storage account, which needs to have all lowercase letters or numbers. I've got my domain credentials. And then the other important thing is if you are using accelerated networking, you need to select a VM size that is compatible with accelerated networking, like the DS4V2. And then we scroll down and check the box for I agree to the terms and hit purchase, and everything is valid. And so our deployment is underway. So our build's finished, and just like before, we have an availability set, our two operating system disks, one shared data disk, storage account, VMs, and proximity placement group. Inside Active Directory, we've got computer objects for the cluster using the distributed network name for our scale-out file server instead of our cluster IP load balancer that you used to have to do. And taking a look at our scale-out file cluster, we go to disks and there is our shared volume. And under the rules, we can see that the volumes are here and shared out, and we've already got some data that is present on those shares ready to be served up to our customers. So by leveraging a shared disk in Azure, we're able to get some of those traditional clustering functions like we used to have on-premise, and there's just a few things to get this up and running. So if this video was a help to you or you learned something new, go ahead and smash that like button and let me know that you appreciated our content, as well as give me some comments down below on questions that you have or things that you'd like us to make videos on in the future. We always want to make what the community is interested in. So remember to stay safe out there, and if you want to keep on learning, check out our latest video up on the top, or you can check out the one on the bottom that Mr. Beast had recommended. Thanks again for joining us this week, and we will catch you soon. Happy learning.